So welcome to today's lecture. Today's lecture is of bipolar junction transistor, and this is an introductory lecture. And this particular subject, this particular chapter belongs to unit 2 of our course on electronic circuits. Now in unit 1, you have already seen that diodes are playing an important role in generating different types of circuits like a rectifier, a filter, as well as different types of wave shaping circuits like a clipper circuit, clamper circuit. And in the last day, we have also discussed about the Zener diode, which is used as a voltage regulator in many of the applications. Now, as you know, diode can be used as an important electronic switch. Similarly, bipolar junction transistor or any type of transistor like junction field effect transistor or metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, so these JFET and MOSFET and as well as BJT, they are also used as an electronic switch. But there must be some difference between the diode and this BJT. First of all, let us try to understand the difference from the device perspective. As you know, for any diode, we have two different electrodes. So that's why the name is diode. So it is known as like dielectrode. You have two electrodes in diode. One is known as the anode. Second one is known as the cathode. So you know that when anode to cathode potential is greater than a certain voltage, like VD on voltage, then the diode will be on. And you can consider that the switch is closed and it can connect the signal source to the load. On the other hand, if the anode to cathode voltage is less than a threshold voltage, then the diode cannot conduct and we can consider the circuit as an open circuit. Now, in case of BJT, as you know, so there are three different terminals, and the terminals are known like emitter, base and collector. So these are the three terminals for BJT. One is known as the emitter terminal, second one is the base terminal, third one is the collector terminal. So unlike diode, for any BJT, you have three terminals. So it's a three terminal device. And it's a kind of PN, so there are two different PN junctions. So between emitter to base, there is one PN junction, and between base to collector, there is another PN junction. So this particular device contains two PN junctions, and it's a three terminal device, namely emitter, base, and collector. Now, depending upon the polarity, whether this emitter is doped with, say, N-type material or P-type material. So depending upon that, so we can have two different types of transistor. One is known as the NPN type of transistor, and the second one is known as the PNP type of transistor. So for NPN type of transistor, emitter and collector, they are of N-type and base is of P-type. On the other hand, for PNP type of transistor, emitter and collector, they are of P-type and base is of N-type. Now, there are two different junctions. One is the base emitter junction, second one is the base collector junction. Now, you can visualize, sometimes you can also think that okay, so there is one PN junction, N to P, there is another PN junction, P to N. Similarly, for PNP transistor, we have one PN junction from P to N, there is another PN junction from N to P. So sometimes people may be confused that whether a transistor can be visualized or can be considered to be equivalent to two diodes connected back to back, because for a diode also, you know, there is one PN junction like PN kind of thing or NP kind of thing. So can I consider the transistor operation to be equivalent to what a diode, what a combination of two diodes do in a series combination? So that is an important question, and let us try to investigate whether this analogy is correct or not. Now, before going into that analogy, whether that transistor operation is equivalent to two diodes connected back to back or not, we have to appreciate the basic transistor principle that the voltage between the two terminals controls the current through the third terminal. So that is a very important statement which has been made over here, that the transistor, in case of transistor, we have two terminals, let it be emitter base or let it be like a base collector. So that depends upon the configuration. So the current that is flowing through the third terminal, this current is basically monitored by the voltage between the two terminals. Now, which two terminals we will be considering for our application, that depends entirely upon the construction of the circuit or the configuration of the circuit. Now, What you're saying that can I consider that a diode, I mean a transistor, like two diodes connected back to back? Now in this particular figure, so there are one PNP transistor is connected in this way. So you can find that PNP, so this is the emitter terminal, this is the base terminal, and this is the collector terminal. Now there is a 5-volt supply, positive battery is connected over here with 1 kilo ohm resistance. In series with that, and we have this base terminal that is connected to ground, and in the collector side we have another 1 kilo ohm resistance, and this is, there is a minus 10 volt kind of thing. So as you may be knowing or not, that for amplification operation, this transistor, two PN junctions, they are biased in different fashion. For example, if I want to use the transistor as an amplifying device, in that case, this base emitter junction must be forward biased and base collector junction must be reverse biased. So I'm coming to that. But in this particular figure, this base emitter junction and the base collector junctions, they are biased in such a way that this particular transistor operates in an active mode or linear mode of operation. Now, suppose I am trying to observe that whether this PNP kind of transistor, this PNP type of BJT, whether this is equivalent to two diodes connected back to back or not. So for this purpose, this PNP has been divided into two different diodes. So this D1 is connected between this point and that point. So this is the emitter terminal of the BJT. This is the base terminal. And this in this side, the right hand side, you have another diode connected in the reverse way. So back to back kind of connection. So N side here, so P side here. So anode to cathode here and cathode to anode here. So I can visualize whether we will be finding the answer whether this kind of realization is acceptable or not. But if I want to represent this PNP as equivalent to PN plus NP, so that could have been the possible realization. So D1 and D2, they are connected back to back like this. Now, if I follow this circuit analogy, or if I follow the different types of circuit laws over here, now you see that this for this particular diode D1, you have a plus 5-volt supply over here. So anode side for this diode is positive with respect to the cathode side. So if I consider that base is grounded, it's a kind of common base configuration. So we'll be discussing what is meant by common base, what is meant by common emitter, and so on. Now here the base is grounded. So for this diode D1, it is forward biased because anode to cathode potential is positive, greater than the threshold voltage. If I assume the threshold voltage to be 0.7 volt for this diode, so you can easily calculate the current that is flowing through this. So this is nothing but 5-volt supply over here, minus this drop, 0.7 volt drop, divided by the resistance R1. So R1 has been selected like 1 kilo ohm. So the current that you are getting that is flowing through this resistance R1 is coming out like 4.3 milliampere. Now, what about the scenario for this second diode D2? Now you see that for the second diode D2, this particular junction, this PN junction is reverse biased. So as I've already mentioned, for the transistor to operate in the active region or linear region, so there are two different junctions, PN junction. One is the base emitter junction, second one is the base collector junction. So now here we are visualizing these two junctions like the two junctions of two individual diodes. So the one junction is forward biased, D1 is forward biased, D2 is reverse biased. Now if D2 is reverse biased, so you expect that this D2 will act as an open switch. So as a matter of fact, no current will flow through D2, and as a matter of fact, no current will flow through this resistance R2. So whatever be the current I1 over here, this total current will flow through this branch, and that is designated like I3. So you find that I2 is equal to 0 since the diode D2 is reverse biased, and I3 is equal to I1, that is 4.3 milliampere. So the current that you are getting through this base terminal, this I3 component, is like 4.3 milliampere. If I consider that this PNP bipolar junction transistor is equivalent to two diodes connected back to back. Now let us try to visualize this transistor, PNP transistor, by means of the equivalent model, equivalent circuit for the BJT. You know that in the input side you have the base emitter junction over here, and this base emitter junction essentially acts like a simple PN junction. Now if we provide a forward bias voltage across this base emitter junction, then obviously the characteristics of this junction or the IV characteristics will be something like a simple current voltage characteristics of a simple diode. Now what happens over this junction, N to P junction? Now you know that I have already mentioned in the first slide that let me go back to the first slide once more. That the voltage between the two terminals controls the current from the third terminal. So the output current is controlled by the voltage between the two terminals. So here I can consider this output current that is flowing through the output circuit of that particular transistor. So here the output current is nothing but the collector current. So this collector current can be regarded as a function of the input voltage. Now here, if I apply KVL within this loop, you will find that this input current and input voltage, they are related to each other. You can easily apply the KVL over this loop and you can find that input current and input voltage, they are related to each other. So as a matter of fact, this output current that is flowing through the collector terminal of the transistor is a function of the input current to some extent, because it's a function of input voltage. So I can write this like alpha times of I1. So I'm coming what is meant by alpha and all. So alpha times of I1. So under this condition, I can just replace this equivalent circuit of the BJT by means of one diode in the first PN junction. This emitter based junction can be regarded like a diode, simple diode with anode side connected to the emitter and the cathode side connected to the base. And between base to collector, this current, so basically it's a current source. You know that this bipolar junction transistor, so let me once again mention what is the meaning of each of the terms, bipolar junction and transistor. First of all, it is known like a bipolar device because as you know that the current is flowing because of the movement of two type of charge carriers. Now here, the two type of charge carriers refer to the electrons and holes. So for BJT, the current, you find that is contributed by both electrons and holes. So that's why it's a bipolar. So junction, there are two different junctions are there. One is a base emitter junction, second one is a base collector junction. And why it is called transistor? Because transistor means a transfer resistor. So as you move from the input side to the output side, you will see that there is a change of resistance. So the resistance offered by this circuit, offered by this transistor circuit, is not constant throughout. So as you move from the input side to the output side, there will be transfer resistance. So that's why it is known as a transistor. So this is the meaning of this term bipolar junction transistor. Now here, as you see that it's basically this transistor, this BJT, is a current control device, unlike a MOSFET, which is a voltage controlled one. So here, the current component, the output current, is basically governed by this input current, that is I1. So I can write this output current like I2 is equal to alpha times I1. Now, if I follow the same analogy, so you'll be getting I1 at like 4.3 milliampere. Now here, I2 is equal to alpha times of I1. And typically, the value of alpha is maximum value is 1. You know the relation between alpha and beta. Now, if I assume that alpha is equal to 1, that is the maximum possible value for alpha, then you can write this I2 is equal to alpha I1, that is equal to 4.3 milliampere. That means whatever be the current that is flowing through this terminal, through this resistance R1, the entire current will flow through this R2. Now, if alpha is less than 1, like 0.99 or 0.98, then 1% or 2% current will flow through this base terminal, through this I3. So ideally, if I select alpha is equal to 1, so in that case, the I3 value will be is equal to 0. So it's a dramatically different scenario. For the last case, while you have realized the transistor by means of two diodes connected back to back, you have seen that current I1 is fixed, that is 4.3 milliampere, which is flowing through the resistance R1. However, the current that is flowing through the base terminal that we have found last time, it was like 4.3 milliampere. That means the total current is flowing through this particular branch because this diode was considered to be, the diode connected here was considered to be reverse biased. However, for this case, we find that just the reverse case, that means the current share has been changed. Here, you find that I3 is equal to 0 ampere, whereas I2 is equal to 4.3 milliampere. So from this particular analysis, we can conclude that we cannot consider in any BJT, whether it's a PNP type of BJT or NPN type of BJT, we cannot consider that any BJT is equivalent to two diodes connected back to back, because the result of this circuit analysis says that this is not at all true. Now that is from the mathematical point of view. Now let us try to understand what is the physical reason behind that. The thing is that whenever we consider a circuit like this, that means a PNP transistor is equivalent to two diodes like D1 and D2 connected back to back. So here we are observing that these two diodes are operating in isolation. That means this particular diode is constructed on a silicon chip and this particular diode D2 is constructed on another silicon chip. So that means physically they are far apart. So they are not connected together. So now if I follow this particular mathematical law, then obviously the current distribution will be different, like 4.3 here, 4.3 milliampere through I3 and 0 milliampere through this R2. However, if I consider a PNP transistor as a whole, you know that this entire transistor is constructed on a particular silicon chip. All the terminals like emitter terminal, base terminal, collector terminal, so all the terminals are constructed on a single wafer. In fact, nowadays, so there are on a single wafer, we have thousands of such transistors, so lakhs of such transistors, as far as the progress in the VLSI is concerned. But even if I consider a single BJT, a PNP or an NPN one, then also on a single wafer, on a single silicon chip, the entire, I mean, two PN junctions are constructed on a single PN junction, on a single silicon chip. Unlike in this case, where we have two diodes and these two diodes are differently connected or they are far apart. So as a matter of fact, since they are not physically apart, these two PN junctions, they are very much present on a single wafer. So this particular analogy is not at all correct. So from this particular thing, we can understand that two diodes connected back to back cannot be considered to be equivalent to a transistor, whether it be NPN or PNP. Now, the next obvious question is that how can we physically associate the operation of any transistor with any of the incidents or events happening around us? Now, let us try to have this analogy. All of us know this particular thing, that we have a tap, a water tap over here, and there is some valve. Now, basically, we can control the flow of water from this point to that point, this inlet point to outlet point. We can control this flow by means of this valve. Now, whenever the valve is in a particular position, then the water flow is minimum. Now, if the valve is, suppose if the valve is at extreme left position, in that case, the water flow is minimum. If the valve is at extreme right position, then the water flow is maximum. So by means of this valve, we can basically control the flow of water or flow of any liquid from this particular point to that particular point. So this can be considered to be an input side of this device, and this can be considered to be an output side of this device. Now, this particular example is taken into consideration because it is also having three different terminals. This input line, this output line, and this is the control line. So input, output, and control. So by using this control valve in a proper way, we can basically control the flow of the water from this point to that point. Now, there could have been two different kind of operation. One operation is that you can position this valve in the extreme left position. So in that case, the current or the amount of water that is flowing, that is minimum. That means we can say that this particular device or this particular apparatus is off. So we are not getting any output at all, outlet at all. On the other hand, if I place this valve on extreme right position, in that case, you'll see that the maximum amount of water will be flowing through this point. So in this case, you'll find that there are two different operations. One is the on operation, second one is the off operation. So similarly, there could have been another operation that whenever I'm changing the valve by small amount, then it can result in a significant change in the outlet. So this is known as the amplification operation. So the BJT can perform these two operations together, but depending upon the bias point and all. So I'll be discussing what is meant by this bias point and all. So in fact, this bipolar junction transistor can perform two types of operation. One is known as the switching operation, and second one is known as amplification operation. Now, similar to this valve and tap analogy, I can say when the tap is at extreme left position, the switch is off, or the tap is off, there is no current, I mean, there is no water flow. And whenever the switch is at the extreme right position, then its maximum amount of water will be flowing through this tap, right? So this is nothing but the switching operation. So I can always consider this to be like digital logic 0 and digital logic 1. So when it is 0, that means it's off. When it is 1, that means it is completely on. Now, in between the extreme left and extreme right position, now if I move this valve by some amount, by some degree, if there is kind of angular rotation, if I rotate by say 15 degree or 20 degree, you will find that a corresponding change in the outlet or the corresponding change in the water will be very much. So this is nothing but the amplification operation. This is nothing but an analog operation. So small change in the valve, that is the third terminal, creates a large change in the output between the first and the second terminal. So this is the fundamental operation which is performed by any transistor. A small change, if you produce a small change in one of the terminals, and that will create a significant change in output between the two terminals. In other words, I can say that this particular terminal will control the flow of the current from this point or to that point, the flow of this water from this point to that point. So this is an amplification operation. And the switching operation to obtain the digital zero or digital one, that depends upon this particular thing you'll be observing whenever you'll be having the course on power electronics, in which case we'll be using the transistor as a switch. So since like a BJT, transistor is also acted as a switch. So the switching operation, that means zero and one, so this has to be there. But apart from that, transistor provides another important operation which is not done by a diode, that is the amplification operation. And moreover, if I want to compare between the diode and the transistor, thing is that in case of transistor, you can basically control the switch position, which is not possible for any diode, because for diode there is no external control. So that's why diode is known as uncontrolled switch. Whenever the anode to cathode voltage is greater than zero, it will be on, or greater than threshold voltage, it will be on. Whenever the anode to cathode voltage is less than the threshold voltage, it will be off. So there is no external control. However, the movement from the on position to the off position, or off position to the on position, the transition from one state to other state, is can be controlled by the corresponding signal voltage at the third terminal for any transistor. So that's why the transistor is known as a fully controlled switch, unlike diode. Diode is uncontrolled switch, and this transistor is fully controlled, because the movement from or the state transition from the one part or one state to the other state is controlled. It can be controlled by providing the signal at the third terminal. And in power electronics, you will study another type of device, which is a power electronic device, which is known as a semi-controlled switch, that is a SCR. So silicon control rectifier thyristor. So where the movement or the transition from the off state to on state can be controlled, but on state to off state cannot be controlled. So that is beyond our syllabus in this particular course. So the statement is that we can have two different operation provided by the transistor. One is the switching operation, in which case the transistor output will be either zero or one or corresponding logic level, and the other one is that the small change in the valve or small change in the third terminal will create large change in the output voltage, and that is the amplification operation. And in this particular course, we will be dealing with this operation, that is the amplification operation. We will be using this BJT in different modes to have different types of amplification. Now this is nothing but the this bipolar junction transistor basics. So you know that there are three terminals, as you know, emitter terminal. Normally it is highly doped, so that's a P plus, highly doped with respect to base and collector. It's P plus, so base collector, base side is N here, and collector side is P. So P plus, N and P. And as you know from your understanding in device physics, that this base terminal, the width of the base terminal is small as compared to the width of the emitter and the collector terminal. And collector terminal is having the maximum width. So we have three different components here. Current component, one is the emitter component here, IE. Second one is the base component of the current, that is IB. And third one is the collector component. So we have three different currents here. The emitter current IE, base current IB, and the collector current IC. Similarly, for NPN transistor, we have emitter is heavily doped with N, so N plus, like a group 5 material. It's doped with group 5 material. Similarly, collector is also doped with group 5 material. However, base is doped with group 3 material. So we have N plus P, N kind of thing, so NPN transistor. Now, basically, we can apply two fundamental laws of the circuit theory. One is the Kirchhoff's current law, and second one is the Kirchhoff's voltage law. So Kirchhoff's current law says that the IE, that is the current entering into the device, if I want to observe this transistor as a black box, so what is the amount of current that is entering? That is IE. What is the amount of current that is leaving the transistor? That is IB plus IC. So IE is equal to IB plus IC. Now the direction of the current will be different for NPN, just the opposite. So you'll see that for PNP transistor, the current is entering through this emitter terminal, whereas for this NPN transistor, current will be leaving through the NPN through this emitter terminal. So this is also symbolized while you represent the transistor in any particular circuit. So KCL says that IE is equal to IB plus IC, and this VEC, this emitter to collector voltage, is nothing but VEB plus VBC. In other words, you can also say that VCE, that is equal to VCB plus VBE, because you know that VEC is nothing but VE minus VC, and VEB is VE minus VB, and VBC is equal to VB minus VC. So if you do this calculation, it comes like VEC is equal to VEB plus VBC. So that is all about the KVL, and from KCL I can say that IE is equal to IB plus IC. Now this is true always, irrespective of the operation, whether the transistor is in the cutoff region or saturation region or active region. So this particular operation holds good always. I mean, this particular equation is always true. IE is equal to IB plus IC. And this particular equation, this KVL, VEC is equal to VEB plus VBC. Now, already I have told you that BJT can be used as an amplifier or as a switch. So for in this particular course, our objective is to ensure that the BJT is acting as a switch. So in this case, so there are three regions of operation. So I'm coming to that. So here, one of the region has been mentioned, that is the active region. Now in case of active region, there are two different PN junctions, as I have already mentioned. One is the emitter base junction and second one is the base collector junction. Now in case of the BJT operating in the active mode or active region or linear region, sometimes it is also called like a linear region, you'll see that this base emitter junction is forward biased and the base collector junction is reverse biased. Now if the transistor is a PNP type, so base emitter junction, so if the transistor is a PNP type, so you see that the emitter is of P type, base is of N type, and collector is of P type. Whereas if the transistor is NPN, then the emitter is of N type, base is of P type, and the collector is of N type. So this is the corresponding circuit symbol, I mean the symbol of the transistor. For PNP transistor, you see that this particular notation, that the current is entering the transistor through this emitter terminal. So that's why the flow of, I mean the direction of the current from this point to that point towards the transistor, towards the baseline. And however, for NPN transistor, current leaves through this emitter terminal. So that's why the current direction at this emitter terminal is outwards. Anyway, in both of these two cases, we will find that IE is equal to IB plus IC. That particular equation holds good. Now, let us first see this emitter, PNP transistor. So for PNP transistor, as I've already told you, that this base emitter junction has to be forward biased. Now, if base emitter junction is forward biased, then what happens? So base, so here you'll find that this base is of N type and emitter is of P type. So in this case, this VEB must be greater than zero. VEB must be greater than zero so that this base emitter junction is forward biased, and VCB must be less than zero so that this base collector junction is reverse biased. Now for NPN transistor, you'll see that this N side, I mean, this emitter is of N type and the base is of P type. So in order to ensure that NPN transistor operates in this active mode or active region, then this VBE, that means base to emitter potential, must be greater than zero. In this case, this PN junction is forward biased. So you can consider this like a simple PN junction, simple diode. So you have P and N over here. Obviously, in order to make this junction forward biased, you have ensured that the potential at the base terminal must be greater than the potential at the emitter terminal, because emitter is of N type, base is of P type. So VBE must be greater than zero and VBC must be less than zero. And that is, and the case for PNP transistor is just the reverse. So for PNP transistor, emitter terminal is connected to, I mean, emitter terminal is of P type and base terminal is of N type. So in order to ensure that this PN junction is forward biased, you have to make sure that the potential at the emitter must be greater than the potential at the base. So in other words, I can say that VEB must be greater than zero and VCB must be less than zero. What happens sometimes, in the last slide I have also shown that this emitter is of P plus type, which suggests that the doping concentration of the holes in the emitter region is high as compared to that of base and collector, in order to ensure that the emitter current density is increased. Now what happens whenever you make this junction forward biased, this PN junction forward biased, obviously the current will flow because of the majority carrier. You know that their hole is the majority carrier in the P side and electron is the majority carrier in the N side. So whenever this PN junction is forward biased, So there is a depletion region width of the depletion region is there, and if you increase the forward bias voltage, the width of the depletion region will be diminished, and as a matter of fact, holes will cross this barrier from p side and will enter to the n side as a minority carrier, and similarly electrons will cross this barrier and it will reach at the emitter side as a minority carrier. So that will be happening over this junction, over this p-n junction, over this base emitter junction. Now what happens over the base collector junction? You'll see that in the base collector junction, VCB for this particular transistor, PNP transistor, you see that VCB is less than zero. What does it mean? VCB less than zero. That means this potential is more as compared to this potential. That means VC is less than VB. That means the collector potential here is less than the base potential. Or if I assume that this base is grounded, so in that case, this collector potential will be at a negative point, like minus 10 volt or minus 8 volt if the base is grounded, so that I can make this VCB less than zero. Now, whenever the extra amount of holes which are crossing this junction, this barrier potential, which are crossing the junction and enters into this base region, obviously there are electrons within the base region, and these holes will be recombined with the electrons and resulting in some current, which is known as a base current. And the rest amount of holes will be situated over here. Now we have already provided a reverse bias across this collector base junction. Now whenever you have provided the reverse bias, so in that case the current will flow only due to the minority carriers. You know that under forward bias condition the current flows due to the flow of the majority carriers, and under reverse bias condition the current will flow or current will be generated due to the flow of minority carriers. Now since if this PCB is less than zero, that means if I consider base potential to be at zero, so collector potential must be negative. So since the negative potential is provided over here, and we have a collector base junction, and that particular junction, since it is reverse bias, so width of the depletion region will be high, but these holes which are located over here, that holes will cross the junction and it will be collected at the collector side because of the negative potential over here, because the collector is at negative potential with respect to the base potential if I consider base to be grounded. And so the emitter current that you are sending through this particular point, through this particular terminal, so that will be divided into two segments. One is the collector current and second one is the base current. Now if I reduce this base region width, in that case the resultant recombination will be less, and as a matter of fact the base current produced will be less. So the majority of the current will be obtained like a collector current. So this ratio, this IC by IE, this collector current by emitter current, their ratio is known to be the alpha. That means the current gain under common base configuration. So I am coming to that. Now similarly, for a NPN transistor, this we have to ensure that VB must be greater than zero and VBC must be less than zero. Now whenever this base emitter junction is forward biased, you know that this is acting like a simple PN junction diode, and the voltage that is developed across these two terminals will be like 0.7 volt, or if I consider some limit like 0.6 to 0.7 volt. So typically this much. Now base collector junction is reverse biased, so you can provide, so it's a reverse bias, so you can provide any amount of voltage, keeping in mind that the amount of voltage must not create any breakdown in the base collector junction. So as long as this breakdown condition is not maintained, so you can increase the base collector junction potential. So that is the scenario when the BJT is acting as an in active mode, or BJT is acting in the linear mode. Now in this particular slide, it has been shown how to use this transistor. So here an NPN transistor is considered for this illustration. So as you know, this direction of the current will indicate whether it's an NPN or PNP. If the direction of the current outwards the transistor through this terminal, so this indicates this is the emitter terminal and this is the NPN. Now if the current is towards the transistor, is towards the baseline, so in that case it will be treated as a PNP transistor. So you understand that this particular transistor is an NPN transistor, and this arrow indicates it's an emitter terminal. So this is the emitter terminal, this is the base terminal, this is the collector terminal. Now there one RB, one resistance is connected, base resistance is connected, and we have a voltage source VBB to ensure that this base, this base emitter junction is forward biased. Now, whether this configuration is true or not, or whether this is a logical one or not, let us try to investigate. We know that in order to operate the transistor in an active region, base emitter junction must be forward biased, and the base collector junction must be reverse biased. Now, base emitter junction is an NPN transistor, so base is of P-type, emitter is of N-type. So in order to ensure that VE junction is hot biased, this VVE voltage must be greater than zero. So that's why this is the polarity. This positive terminal of the battery is connected to the base and the negative terminal is connected to the emitter. Now, in order to ensure that the current is within the prescribed limit, so we have inserted on resistance, obviously. So we need to insert this resistance to limit the current or to some extent to control the current. So this RB is there in series with that. And this will make this particular junction, base emitter junction, forward biased. Now, over here, you see that this NPN transistor, so obviously this is this collector is of N-type. So if I connect the positive terminal of the battery through this collector, so in that case, this collector emitter collector base junction will be reverse biased. Now, the total current, you can have this total current IE is equal to IB plus IC and VC is equal to VCB plus VB, as obvious. Now let us see the different characteristics of the transistor. So to start with, let us consider the input characteristics. So here we are considering that the transistor is having a three terminals. So the terminals are base, emitter, and collector. Now if I want to model the transistor as a two-port network, so for two-port network, you know that there must be two terminals for the input side, there must be two terminals for the output side. But you don't have four different terminals to operate. You have only three terminals. So what is the situation or what is the solution? You have to use one terminal as common to both input and output. So accordingly, you can have three different configuration. If I want to make the base terminal to be common with respect to the input and output, then it is known as a common base configuration. If I want to use the emitter terminal to be common with respect to input and output, then it is known as a common emitter configuration. Similarly, if you have the collector terminal to be common with respect to base and input, base and emitter, then it is known as a common collector kind of configuration. So typically, this common emitter kind of configuration is having its own implications and own advantages in different electronic circuits. So let us start with the input characteristics of any common emitter transistor. So this has been also shown over here. If you just observe this circuit, you'll see that this emitter terminal, this is grounded, and we are applying the input signal or the input bias we are applying with respect to this emitter terminal, and the collector side is also this particular voltage VCC is also applied with respect to this collector to emitter. So that's why here in this particular circuit, you'll see that this emitter terminal is acting as a common terminal to both this base and as well as collector. Although we have not shown any external signal, which is obviously required for amplification operation. So similarly, we have this common base configuration and common collector configuration. Now here, if I want to observe the characteristics of this type of circuit or input characteristics, you'll see that here the input current, as you understand, what is input current? Input current is obviously the base current, right? So base current is input current, and what is the input voltage? This is nothing but the base to emitter voltage. So base to emitter voltage across this, what is the available base to emitter voltage? This is nothing but the input voltage, and IB, that is the base current, is nothing but the input current. Similarly, for the output circuit, output current is the collector current, and this collector to emitter voltage is nothing but the output voltage. So whenever you are asked to draw the input characteristics of any device, so in that case, this for this particular circuit, the input current will be IB and the input voltage will be VB. Now, how does it look like? This is nothing but a simple PN junction characteristics, because this VB base to emitter junction is basically a forward biased PN junction. So you know already how to draw or how to plot the IB characteristics of any diode. So the similar thing is also shown over here. Across this line, we have the applied voltage over here. This is the VBE. And across this line, we have this current, that is IB. IB is flowing across this. So VB versus IB. So you know what is the relationship? Relationship is nothing but its exponential kind of nature is there with the amount of the threshold voltage is there beyond which point this curves will take off. Now, basically, this input characteristics is nothing but the plot of IB as a function of VBE and as well as VCE. Now, let us try to restrict our discussion on a particular VCE. Let it be 2-volt only. Suppose VCE, which is output parameter, let us consider this output parameter to be constant at 2-volt only. Then how does it look like? This input to output, input current versus input voltage, it looks like a simple exponential nature. Simple volt ampere characteristics of a PN junction diode. Now, what happens when you increase VCE? Here you see that as you increase VCE from 2-volt to 6-volt and 6-volt to 10-volt, you see that you require more amount of VBE to turn the base emitter junction so that the IB is greater than zero. Because as you increase this collector emitter junction, I mean the collector emitter voltage, VCE voltage, what happens? In order to ensure that the base emitter junction is forward biased, you require more amount of VB. Otherwise, this IB cannot be greater than zero. So that's why you find that as VCE increases from 2 volt to 6 volt or 6 volt to 10 volt, the threshold voltage beyond which this curves will take off, this threshold voltage is also increasing. So here, if it is like 0.4 volt here, now it will become 0.45 or it will become 0.5 over here. Or in other words, if I consider a particular VB value, so let us fix this VB value to be at 1 volt, and now if I compare the current component because of different VCE, you'll see that if the VCE value is more, in that case, for a fixed VB, the IB value is less. And the second important thing is that the variation of this output current, this IB current with respect to this VBE. We see that this response is nothing but an exponential nature. Now, obviously, this current versus voltage variation will not be linear one, because you know that current I is equal to some IS into e to the power VB by VT minus 1. So exponential nature. So even if I allow that this variation, this delta VB is varying over a certain range, so we can't ensure that the corresponding variation IB, this delta IB, is linearly proportional with this delta VB, because this variation is not linear, this is an exponential variation. So that's why the concept of small signal, once again, as we have discussed in the last day also, that the variation of this input current, the input voltage delta VB, must be small enough in order to ensure that within this particular range, this exponential nature can be treated to be equivalent to a linear one. So in that case, this delta VB variation and delta IB variation can be represented by means of some proportionality constant. Otherwise, if I want to incorporate the higher order terms, x square, cube, and so on, in this case, the variation in delta, this delta IB, that means the current variation, cannot reflect the corresponding voltage variation over here. Now let us look at the output characteristics. So for output characteristics, so there are two different parameters. One is the collector current, second one is the collector emitter voltage, whenever we are considering the common emitter configuration. So here you see that this VC versus IC, this variation we have to plot for different values of IB. So in case of input characteristics, you have different value of, for input characteristics, we have this IB versus VB variation with the different values of this VCE. So these are the output parameters, VC 2 volt, VC 6 volt, VC 10 volt, and so on. And here, the output characteristics is drawn with respect to VC and IC, so IC versus VC graph, for different values of input parameters, IB 10 microampere, 20 microampere, 30 microampere, and so on. So from these output characteristics, you can simply observe the different regions of operation. So this region is the active region where the output current, this IC, the variation of IC with respect to IB is linear one. So here you see that when IB is equal to 60 microampere, the current IC is equal to like 6 milliampere. When IB is equal to 50 microampere, the current is like 5 milliampere. When the IB is equal to 20 microampere, then the current IC is equal to 2 milliampere. So the variation in IC with respect to the variation in IB is linear within that particular range. So that's why it is known as a linear region of operation. Whereas this region is known as a cutoff region, where the amount of base current is insignificantly small, very small in nature. And this region, when the current, the collector current is very large, this particular region is known as a saturation region. So there are three regions of operations: cutoff region, active or linear region, and the saturation region. Now in cutoff region, both the junctions, because the base current is zero, so base current zero are very small. So that means you understand that the current that is flowing through the PN junction is very small, and that is only possible when you make both the junctions reverse biased. Now, if both the junctions, both the base emitter and the base collector junctions, if both of them are reverse biased, then only you can have this cutoff region. Then the transistor is operated in the cutoff region. However, for active region, as you know, base emitter junction is forward biased, but base collector junction is reverse biased, in which case you will find that IC and IB, they will maintain a proportionality relation. That means if IC is equal to 6 milliampere, IB will be 60 microampere. If IB is equal to 30 microampere, IC is equal to 3 milliampere. That means if IB increases by 100%, then IC also will also increase by 100%. So the linear relationship is taking place between IV and IC. So that is why it is known as an active region or linear region. And this is very much essential to use the transistor as an amplifier. So perhaps in the next or perhaps in the next class or in the next class, we will be discussing about the essential attributes of amplifiers. There you will see that this particular nature of the transistor to operate in the active region is a very important characteristic that we have to ensure. And the saturation region is where the collector current is very large. So we can ensure that this collector to emitter voltage is very small within that particular range. So now we can simply observe the transistors used as different means. So whenever we want to use the transistor as an amplifier, we have to operate the transistor within the active region, within this particular range. So the value of this base current must be between this 10 micro to 60 micro or so. Now, whenever the transistor is acting as a switch, then I have to operate the transistor either in the cutoff region or in the saturation region. So in the cutoff region, the current is very small, irrespective of the amount of voltage. Whatever be the voltage you apply, the current is very small. So in that case, we can regard the transistor is acting as an open switch. So that means there is no conduction of current. So current is zero or very small. And whenever the current is very high, so in which case I can consider that the transistor is operated as a closed switch, so saturation region. And so in our case, we will be basically dealing with this operating the transistor within the active region. Now, these are the some relationships which you need to remember for different mathematical problem solving kind of thing, or even for analyzing the circuits in a better way. One is this IC is equal to beta times IB, and IC is equal to alpha times IE. Perhaps you know this relationship. So alpha and beta, these are known as the current amplification factor, but in different configuration. As you know, that base current will be the input current for common emitter configuration, and collector current will be the output current for the common emitter configuration. So this IB into beta, that is equal to IC. So you can easily observe that beta is nothing but the current amplification factor. IC is the output current and IB is the base current for the transistor operating in common emitter mode. So IC by IB, that ratio beta, is nothing but the common emitter current gain or current amplification factor, common emitter current amplification factor, and which is obviously very large, in the order of 100 or 200 or even high. And similarly, this IC is equal to alpha I, this relationship will also hold good. And this is nothing but, this alpha is nothing but the common base current amplification factor. Because for common base configuration, this input current will be the emitter current and output current will be the collector current, just like the previous one. So once again, if I want to compute this IC by IE, that ratio, output by input ratio, so alpha will be coming, and this alpha is nothing but the common base current amplification factor. Now you know that relationship is true, IE is equal to IB plus IC. Now if I want to equate these two, you'll find that this is the relationship, alpha is equal to beta by 1 plus beta, and beta is equal to alpha by 1 minus alpha. So the maximum value of alpha is equal to obviously 1, because as I was mentioning the device physics a little bit, then you have seen that the amount of current that we're injecting for any transistor through this emitter terminal, this current is divided into two different segments. One is through this base terminal, that is IB, and the other one is through the correct terminal, that is IC. If I inject, suppose, 10 milliampere of current, and out of that, say 10 microampere is flowing through the base terminal, and the rest amount of current, that is 10 milli minus 3 micro, is flowing through the collector terminal. So that is so quite obvious that the emitter current the collector current cannot exceed the emitter current. So this ratio alpha must be less than 1. If I ensure the base current is very small, in that case alpha will be 1, otherwise alpha will be less than 1. Now if alpha is equal to 1, so ideally it will be beta will be infinite, but that is not the case. Normally we select alpha to be like 0.99 or so. In that case, beta will be very large or even high. And that is true always, I is equal to IC plus IB. So you have to remember this equation. But at the same time, you have to understand that these relationships are only for the active region of operation. If I consider the cutoff region, or if I consider that the transistor is operating in the saturation region, then obviously this relationship does not hold good. This IC is equal to beta IB or IC is equal to alpha IE, this relationship is true only in the active or linear region. So that's why the term linear, because the base current and the collector current, they are linearly related. Emitter current and collector current, they are linearly related. But that is not the case for the transistors operating in the cutoff, either in the cutoff or in the saturation. However, this is always true. This emitter current is equal to collector current plus base current. This is always true. But this relation is not true always. IC is equal to beta IV and IC is equal to alpha IV. This is only true in the cutoff region. In the saturation, your active or linear region. But this is not true neither in cutoff nor in saturation. Now, an important analysis in terms of the load line. So what is meant by load line? Now, here, we are using the transistor in a particular circuit. So transistor must follow some mathematical models. As for example, as you have already seen that this emitter current is equal to base current plus collector current. As you have already seen, transistors operated in the active or linear region, you have this IC is equal to beta IV or IC is equal to alpha I. These relationships hold good. But whenever, so this particular formula, these particular relationships are very much related to the transistor itself. It has nothing to do with the circuit in which the transistor is inserted. On the other hand, if I want to introduce or want to incorporate that particular BJT in any particular circuit, then obviously there must be some circuit law. So there are two different kind of things. One is the circuit law and second one is the device law. So device law and circuit law, they must handshake with each other in order to obtain the final solution. Let me try to explain further. Now here, this transistor is connected in this way. It's a common emitter configuration, NPN transistor. So we have RB over here, and we have this RC over here, the base resistance and the collector resistance, and we have two different the bias signal, VBB and VCC. Now you can, if I want to find out the load line, before going to the load line, let us try to apply KVL over this loop. What we find is, this VBB is equal to IB RB. You have VBB is equal to IB RB plus VBE. If I apply KVL, or VBE minus VBB plus IB RB is equal to zero. Or if I want to represent IB in terms of VBE, then it will be something like that. IB is equal to minus VBE by RB plus VBB by RB. That is true, obviously. But remember that it depends upon the value of VBB and RB. If I change VBB or RB, obviously the corresponding graph will be shifted to some extent. On the other hand, if I go to the output side, then you'll see that this VCE, this collector to emitter voltage, is given by VCC minus ICRC. So in that case, I can write IC is equal to minus VCE by RC plus VCC by RC. So whenever I use this transistor in this particular circuit, so these equations are coming, this input side equation and this output side equation, these equations are coming by incorporating the transistor within that particular circuit. But remember that the current voltage characteristics of the transistor will follow the input and output characteristics, as you have already seen, the three regions, like input, like cutoff region, active region, saturation region. Now, whenever you are using the transistor in that particular circuit, the current, the resulting current that you are getting, like IC, or the resulting voltage that you are getting, PC, that must satisfy both of these two parameters. That means the parameters from the input from the transistor side, as well as the parameter from the circuit side. So we have this output characteristics over here, as I already mentioned. This this cross section, these are nothing but the cutoff region over here, and these are the saturation region, the hashed one. The cutoff and the saturation region. Cutoff means when the base current is very small, and saturation means when the collector current is very high. So we have two different regions. So in saturation region, we consider that the transistor is fully on, whereas for the cutoff region, the transistor is fully off. Now, between these two lines, IV is equal to 0 to IV is equal to IV max, between this point A to between this point B, between A to B, the transistor is operated in the active or linear region. Now, in the last slide, we have already got this IC is equal to minus VCE by RC plus VCC by RC. Like your output characteristics, here we have two different parameters. One is the collector current IC, and second one is the collector to emitter voltage VCE. So similarly, like an input output characteristics of any BJT, I can always draw this IC versus VCE. Now, how does it look like? IC is equal to minus VCE by RC plus VCC by RC. So if I want to correlate with y is equal to mx plus c, you'll see that here m is equal to negative. M is equal to negative minus 1 by rc. Y is equal to, so y, the output variable here is the dependent variable, that is ic, and independent variable is vce. So, and this is the c, the constant term. So y is equal to mx plus c. So m is equal to here minus 1 by rc. and C is equal to VCC by RC. Then obviously slope is negative. So since the slope is negative, I can represent this IC is equal to minus VCC by RC plus VCC by RC by means of this particular straight line. Now let us try to identify the two extreme points. Now when IC is equal to zero, when IC is equal to zero, you will find that VC is equal to VCC in this particular equation. If I put IC is equal to zero, you will find that VCC is equal to VCC is equal to VCE. So when IC equal to zero, VC is equal to VCC. So this is one point over here, and you know to obtain the other point, let us put VCE is equal to zero. Now if I put VCE equal to zero, then you will find that IC is equal to VCC by RC. So there are two parameters. One is IC, second one is VC. Now you know to obtain the two extreme points, I have to put IC is equal to zero and VC is equal to zero. So for IC is equal to zero, VC is equal to VCC, and for VC equal to zero, IC equal to VCC by RC. So these two points are obtained. This is for VCE is equal to zero, so IC is equal to VCC by RC. This is the other point. When IC is equal to zero, then VCE is equal to VCC. And these are the two extreme points, and all the variations are through this line, through this straight line. So you can easily find out the slope of the straight line. How to find out the slope? Here you see that this ordinate is VCC by RC, and this one is VCC. So ordinate like y2 by y1, if I calculate, I mean y by x, if I want to calculate this one, then you'll see that this is coming like VCC by RC divided by VCC, so 1 by RC with a negative slope, because this is negatively inclined, so minus 1 by RC. So this is the slope of the straight line. So this particular straight line, this one, IC is equal to minus VC by RC plus VCC by RC, can be represented by means of this straight line. These are the two extreme points, this point and that point. And this line is known as the load line. And why load line? Because this value, the slope of this particular load line, is very much dependent upon the load resistance RC. What is the slope of the straight line? The slope is minus 1 by RC, as you know. Minus 1 by RC is the slope. So if I change the value of this RC, in that case, the slope will be modified. And if I change this supply voltage VCC, then obviously, these two points will be different. So it can be done simultaneously. Either you keep VCC constant, change RC. If I keep VCC constant, but if I change RC, then what happens? This point will be fixed. This point will be fixed. This is at VCC, but this slope will be different. This point will move along this line by changing RC, but keeping VCC constant. On the other hand, if I keep RC fixed, but if I change VCC, then obviously this straight line, both of these two points, these two extreme points will be shifted, but it will be shifted in a parallel way. Why parallel way? Because this slope minus 1 by RC, that is constant. RC is constant. So if I change VCC, if I increase VCC, then this particular straight line will be shifted along this direction. And if I reduce the value of VCC, then it will be shifted along this direction. So, but in parallel with this original straight line. So depending upon the value of VCC and RC, the orientation of the straight line will be different. Now, this red line is coming from the circuit perspective. If I apply this KVL over this base emitter loop and the collector emitter loop, you'll be getting those two equations. So this red line that we have got, red straight line, that is coming from the circuit perspective. Whereas this blue line, they are coming from the device perspective. This blue line has nothing to do with the circuit, because this is the property of the transistor. You know that if IC is equal to this much and VC equal to that much, then you know what will be the, I mean, if the IB value is this much, suppose IB is equal to 50 microampere, then you know what will be the value of IC. That is very much dependent upon the transistor property. So it is nothing but a device property, this blue line. And these red lines, they are coming from the circuit operation. So now, since you are using the device, this BJT, into the circuit itself, so obviously the current that you are getting, this IC value, this collector current or output current, it must satisfy both the device as well as the circuit perspective, because the same current, so this particular current is having its obligation both in the device as well as in the circuit. So in order to obtain what is the output current IC for any particular value of VB or RB, then how to find this out? As you know, these blue lines are for different IB. This is for IB0, this is for IB1, this is for IB2, this is for IB3, and so on. Now, suppose I want to use this BJT in this particular circuit, and I would like to know what will be the output current resulting from this particular circuit. Now, how to get this? Mathematically, I can always calculate, but graphically, how to calculate? So first of all, you have to find out what is the amount of the base current. Suppose the base current is equal to 30 microampere, for example. If I know that the base current is 30 microampere, then in the output characteristics, I have to look at this particular point. So suppose this is IV is equal to 0 microampere, this is 10 microampere, this is 20 microampere, this is 30 microampere. This is 30 microampere. So ID is equal to 30 microampere. So I have to look at this particular line, this line. This is 30 microampere, this line. Now this line, so this is the device line. This is coming from the device property, this blue line. And this red line is coming from the circuit property. Now where these two lines are intersecting at this particular point. So obviously this is the resultant output current IC. So accordingly, I can find this is the value of IC, like 40 kind of thing. I think, yeah. So 40 or like 35 milliampere kind of thing. And this will be the corresponding PC value, this much. Now suppose I have used a particular value of VBB or RB in such a way that the base current is like only 20 microampere. So since the base current is 20 microampere, then obviously I have to look at the first, second, third, this particular line, this line. Third line from the bottom, zero, this is 10, this is 20 microampere. So now here, this particular line is intersecting with the straight line, with the load line at this particular point, R. So R will be my quiescent point. Why it is called quiescent point? Because so far we have not applied any small signal. We have not applied any time fading signal. We are just applying the DC signal, like VBB, VCC, in order to ensure that the device is operated in the active region. So accordingly, R will be the output current, output voltage. From this particular point R, we can have what is the output current and output voltage. Similarly, if I increase the value of IB to say 40 microampere, in that case, it will be like the point P. It will be like the point P because P is the point of intersection between these blue graphs and the red graph. So P will be the intersection. Similarly, if I increase it further, the IB value, once a point will come when the intersection goes beyond this active region or linear region, then it will move to the saturation region. So this is not at all advisable in our case. Similarly, I cannot use any value of IB, which is very small. So in that case, it will be moving to the cutoff region. So this particular straight line, this load line, will give you some information regarding the resultant output current and resultant output voltage under DC condition. Why DC condition? Because so far we had not applied any kind of small signals over here. We have applied only the DC bias, VBB over here and VCC over here. So the current that you are getting over here, IC or IB or IE, whatever be the value, or even VC, VBB, these are the constant quantities. This is not a time varying quantity, this is a constant one. So to understand the BJT as an amplifier, first of all, you have to understand the platform. And this platform is all about the DC analysis. Once you have the DC analysis, then you can know what is all about the AC analysis. So that will be discussed in the subsequent lectures. So this load line will give you the correct information regarding the quiescent point or the DC point of this particular transistor. Now let us consider some problem solving over here. So here, one BJT has been shown for which the base voltage, supply is 4 volt, bias voltage is 4 volt over here, and you need to find out what will be the base current. So here, so 220 kilo ohms base resistance is connected in series with that. Now, if the device is on, so you can expect that there is the 0.7 volt drop over here, or you can simply write VB. So if you apply KVL over this loop, I can write VB minus 4 plus IB into 220K is equal to 0 if I apply KVL. And from that, putting the value of VB to be 0.7 volt, you will find that the current is coming like 15 microampere. This is 15 microampere, the current. Because this is this dotted line, this is the base emitter junction characteristics. So they have considered this constant voltage model of this PN junction diode. So this base emitter junction is basically acting as a diode, PN junction diode. So this base emitter junction characteristics looks like a simple straight line like this, the constant voltage model. So this will be like 0.7 volt over here. But what is the current? What is the current amount? How to get this value? In order to get the current value, you have to find out this load line resulting from the input circuit So for input circuit also, you can simply write this VBE minus 4 plus IB into 2NDK, that is equal to 0. So now you have these two parameters. One is the VBE, second one is IB. This is also, this particular graph is also the variation of IB with respect to VBE. So accordingly, you can have what is the slope of the graph. This is a one-segment straight line, the load line for the input circuit. Now this is the load line for the input circuit, and this is the input-output characteristic, I mean, input current voltage characteristics for this base emitter junction. Now these two lines, they are intersecting at this particular point. So this value will give you the base current. What is the base current value? This is 15 microampere, as you are getting from mathematics as well. Now, you have to apply the same thing over, I think this is next problem. And this shows a different kind of circuit with the VV is equal to 6 volt and RB is equal to 25 kilo ohms. Now the emitter terminal is not grounded, rather it is grounded through a resistance of 0.6 kilo ohm, and we have 0.4 kilo ohms resistance at the collector side with a 12 volt supply. Here also I can write the same equation, VV is equal to IB RB plus VB on plus IE RB. So last time this was grounded, so this potential was grounded, so collector to emitter voltage was like only collector voltage because the emitter was grounded, and here the collector to emitter voltage is equal to only this voltage between this point and that point because emitter is not grounded. So if I apply KVL across this base loop, I can write VBB is equal to IBRB plus VB on plus IERD, and from that I can find out what is the value of IB, because you know that IE, that is emitter current, as long as the transistor is operated in the active region or linear region, this emitter current is the summation of the base current and the collector current. So IB plus IC. What is IC? IC is equal to beta times IB. So by solving for IB, we can have IB is equal to VBB minus VB on divided by RB plus 1 plus beta times RE. And if I put those values, you'll be getting the value of base current to be 75.1 microampere. 75.1 microampere is the base current for this particular circuit, putting beta is equal to 75. Now, solving for the your output circuit, output loop, you'll see that this VCC is equal to VCE plus ICRC plus IERD. Or in other words, I can say that ICRC plus VCE plus IERD minus VCC equal to 0. So if I put and IE, you know, IE is equal to IC by alpha, collector current by the alpha. From that, you can represent VCE is equal to 12 minus IC into 1.01. If I put those values, this is the variation with respect to VC versus IC. So you see here, so Y is equal to MX plus C with M is equal to minus 1.01 and C is equal to 12. Y is equal to, no, so VC is equal to 12 minus IC into 1.01. So you have to represent IC to be VC minus VC by 1.01 minus 12 by 1.01. So your M will be minus of 1.01, right? So accordingly, this black line is obtained. So there are two extreme points. One is VC is equal to 0, and second one is IC is equal to 0. Now, when VC is equal to 0, you can find out what is the value of IC. If VC is equal to 0, IC will be like 12 by 1.01. IC will be 12 by 1.01 when VC is equal to 0, and this value you are getting like 11.9 milliampere. So this is the maximum possible current that you are getting out of this, that is 11.9 milliampere, 12 by 1.01. And whenever your IC is equal to 0, in that case, what is the VC? That is nothing but the VCC, the total supply voltage. So in that case, it will be at 12. So these two points, if I join these two points, so you know how to draw a straight line. So there are different mechanisms available. So in one case, if you know the slope of the straight line, and if you know any particular point on the straight line, then you can draw the straight line. Or if you know the two points on a straight line, x1 comma y1 and x2 comma y2, then also you can draw the straight line. So there are different mechanisms available. So either you write like this y minus y1 by y1 minus y2 is equal to x minus x1 or x1 minus x2, or this one particular point and the slope, if it is known, then you can draw the straight line. So here we know the two points here. This is one point intersection at this vertical axis, and the position at the horizontal axis. If I know these two points, I can easily draw the straight line. So this straight line, this black line, is giving you the information regarding the circuit operation. How does the circuit operate? Because this is all about, we are obtaining this by analyzing the circuit over here, by applying KVL and all, right? So this is a black line coming from the circuit operation. And this blue line are coming from the device perspective, because we are using the BJT in this particular circuit. Now, we don't expect that whenever the value of IB is this much, so So we know that this will be the halo of IC. This will be the halo of BC. We know that. So it cannot behave abruptly. So accordingly, if the blue lines are there, which are nothing but the variation of the output current with respect to the output voltage VC, I can have these blue lines. Now these two lines, I mean, you know, to obtain the resultant output current that is flowing through this transistor or through this circuit, that is IC. So obviously it must satisfy both of these two lines, this the blue line as well as this black line, and this intersection is over here. So you might argue, why this point, why not that point? Because in order to select that which blue line to be selected, I have to find out what is the value of IB. As you have already seen, the value of IB is like 75.1 microampere. If I analyze this base emitter circuit, then or from the input load line, you can also know that the value of IB is equal to 75.1 microampere. So if it is 75.1 microampere, so there could have been different such ICVC characteristics. Now if it is like 75.1 microampere, and suppose this blue line is for 75.1 microampere, accordingly I can calculate what is the value of IC, that is equal to 5.63 milliampere. So obviously I have to select this blue line as my current under consideration, and accordingly I can know what is the value of VCE that can be obtained by this equation, 12 minus IC into 1.01. You know IC value, that is 75.1 micro. If I put this value over here, you'll be getting 5.63. That is, 12 minus 5.63 into 1.01, and that is coming like 6.31. This is also guaranteed from this intersection itself. So if I just project this over here, over this VC axis, you'll find that this value is like 6.31 volt. So from this Q point analysis, from this quiescent point analysis, you can know what is the value of this output current and output voltage resulting from any circuit just by observing the different IB characteristics as well as the load lines. Now, with this, let me conclude today's section regarding the introductory lecture of this bipolar junction transistor.